Yes.
Okay, thank you. So let's hope the recording works. excuse me, I'm still a bit, I'm not completely over my flu. Okay, for those of you who don't know me, I will do part of the introduction that I was supposed to give last Tuesday. What I do, for those of you who don't know me, as I said, I mostly lecture in system and network engineering, and about 6 to 7 years ago, we started a, it wasn't a minor then, but we started a specialization in security and forensics together with the University of Amsterdam. At some point, that didn't work out for scheduling reasons anymore, about 2 years ago. We're still doing it, they're still doing it, but on completely different timetables and so on. So it still lives on, and however, everything must come to an end. So this is the last year for those who are doing the minor forensics that will be giving the minor forensics. We split it into two. There's simply too much to teach in too little time. We'll have the theme semester security and the theme semester forensics, or rather digital forensic investigations, starting next year. So I also do e-discovery, but that's more or less a certain branch of forensics. And I do that in my capacity as a researcher for the lectorate in e-discovery. So e-discovery is pretty much, I don't know if Carla told you about it, it deals with big data analysis in companies. For instance, if they go into a company and they say, well, we'll take all your servers with us, the company's going to say no. So all they will get at best is a copy. Here's all the email, and you figure it out for your investigation. And they're stuck with several million emails, and they need to find out what happened, or they need to find the traces they were looking for. So you can imagine it's a highly specialized field, and it's very closely related to all this big data stuff you're hearing about. I'm also the CISNet admin for our own faculty. So most of you have encountered me in that capacity before as the person behind UGE, for instance, or the lab you see in the fourth floor, and so on. You can find out a whole lot more about me on LinkedIn. I've given guest lectures all over Europe by now in the field of security forensics and e-discovery. If you send me an invite, I might accept. Might. It's nothing personal, really. If I don't accept it, it's honestly nothing personal, but I have about 500 people in my LinkedIn already, and that's just colleagues I've directly worked with foreign or here. So I need to, most students I instantly click accept when they're alumni. That's how I usually do it. So and of course I'm the head of the theme semester security, the official one. Carla is my second in command, pretty much, and likewise for the forensics theme semester next year. The roles are reversed. Carla is primarily in charge, and I'm the second one. So what I like, and for those of you who know me from previous lessons, I like active participation. So if you want to know something, please raise your hand and just ask away. I'd rather have all questions answered and not finish my lecture at the end of the day than the other way around, not answered all questions and finished my lecture, because I know from experience there's always tons of questions and so on. That brings me to another point, and specifically what I mean with who are you. We have several special guests here. I don't want to single you out too much, but we have a very special guest from the Ministry of Defense, and I'm sorry I probably messed up your rank, but it's been a while since I actually knew how to read all these signatures, but it's captain, sorry, already, okay. He's a captain, he works for the CERT team, I believe, from defense. So every year we try to do this, have special guests over from the industry, people in the field who deal with this kind of thing every day. Last year we had, for instance, two people from KPN who were in the CERT team. So, and that goes for all of you. I'm pretty sure that some of you have already done some work in security. Am I right? Some people nodding. There's always some people who have done this stuff already. So, and I know that you have experiences to tell. So if you have an interesting thing to add, or you want to tell us about something that has happened, please do so. If you want to do it on certain conditions, that is to say, it doesn't leave this room, we can all agree on that. So it's kind of like Scout's Honor. in that regard. It's called the Chatham House Rule, for instance, or they, in certain terms, they use TLP, the Traffic Light Protocol. No problem at all. We'll agree about that beforehand. Just say, I have something to share, but I would like it not to leave this room. We all agree on that explicitly. It will be recorded. So we'll stop the camera at that point, but it will be on camera that we all agreed to that. Very simply put. And when you're done sharing your story, we'll start recording again. But I would really like to invite you to do that. We had very interesting topics, discussions, and everything about that. Everything about security and forensics pretty much got discussed last year as a result. Okay, so the overall course schedule. I think Carla has shown you this already. This slide? No? This is for the infrastructure part. So this is what we'll be doing today, and some of you, particularly the students who have followed system and network engineering, will be well familiar with these subjects. It is a bit of a necessary evil. We apologize for this. It is simply because not all students who are here are system and network engineering, so we need to get you up to the same level. So, the learning goals for today. So if you need, so if you're wondering, you're sitting at home, you're looking at the lecture again, and you're wondering what you need to learn to pass the exams, start by looking at the learning goals. They will give you an overall view of what you need to know for the exams. So, please be careful, this is not everything, and there's a lot more questions possible than literally these. If we turn these into questions, they are very vague, but you need to know about the details as well. And you will see this every time in every lecture as well. We'll gradually, over the course of this semester, be covering all the, for the theme semester security students particularly, all the CISSP areas of knowledge. So, for the exams, what can you expect? Apart from what we've been telling you in the lectures, everything in the book, if you're a theme semester student, everything in the lectures, particularly things, don't forget, could be included from the guest lectures, but we might also just simply use the CISSP questions. As you can probably understand, there are exam questions for CISSP available, we have them, so we might also be asking questions for that, from that. So apart from using the book as a study reference, you can also start by looking at the CISSP exams to get an indication of what kind of questions you might expect. So, does that give you a good idea of what we're going to do? Perfect. Like I said, if you have a question, please ask. Okay, so, first thing today. It's an introduction from Kuros and Ross. What are we going to do? We're going to talk about infrastructure security. And that implies that first we all agree on what infrastructure is. So we've made a split between infrastructure and software. Now, as you all know, particularly with virtualization these days, these things are becoming rather vague. What is software and what is actual infrastructure and hardware? But for all intents and purposes, we need to make the split somewhere. So it's down here. So we'll talk about what's the internet, what's the protocol, the network core. We'll briefly touch on security, obviously, and about protocols, layers, models, and so on. So, the network core. And I assume these diagrams are more than familiar. So when we talk about infrastructure, generally we recognize different sets of equipment as parts, as huge parts of a network. So we generally talk about the mobile network and everything from, let's say, WiMAX, so the latest Wi-Fi things for metropolitan coverage in cities, to maybe GSM and all its variants and evolutions and so on, but also car telephones that used to exist. That's all considered the mobile network. We have ISPs at the global level. We have ISPs at the regional level, and they obviously operate as this. They are described. There's a global one. You have to operate globally. They are mostly concerned, usually, with not just normal customers, but sometimes primarily, sometimes mostly with building huge networks to serve these regionals. You have home networks and you have institutional networks. So to think of this, to give you an idea of scale, it's actually quite simple. Home networks, most of you have this, I would assume, if you're an IT student. You have more than one computer, and even if you don't realize it and you only have one computer, one laptop, most of you will also be using your network or Wi-Fi or whatever with your mobile phone. So that's the home network. You're connected to a regional ISP. Maybe it's UPC, maybe it's Access for All, and so on. What's an example of an institutional network? The HVA, for instance, which has actually merged with the UVA by now, the University of Amsterdam. But these are institutional networks. They pretty much do the same thing. They're still networks. They're designed for interconnections between machines, sharing data, connecting to the internet, and so on. So they're probably still going to be hooked up to a regional ISP, although it's a different one in the case of the HVA. But that's pretty much the difference between the scales of these two. You will sometimes see terms such as, for these metropolitan area networks, to give an indication of the scale, MANs. So you might have heard of a LAN, which is usually at your place at home, a local area network. But there are things like WANs, wireless area network. But you also have things like MANs, metropolitan area networks. So metropolitan, as in the term that's used to describe cities, the HVA has that. We have multiple locations, as you know, but we have our own fiber ring between these locations and so on and so on. But these are much bigger in scale and so on. So how does the traffic get moved between these different networks as needed? So let's assume someone on the mobile network wants to talk to a server at the HVA. Maybe it's you on your bike, you're on your way here, and you want to check your schedule. It happens with routers and switches. So I'm not going to dive too much into details because I assume you know all this by now. It's just to get the non-SNE students up to speed. So there's everything from end systems. It could be PCs, servers, wireless laptops, smartphones. But you know, well, these days it's even toasters, smart fridges. We're starting with the Internet of Things. Is there anyone, by any chance, busy with domotica already in their home? No, you can, usually with your smartphone, you can turn on the lights at home and turn up the heating. Nobody? Okay. But it's all the same thing. It's still computers, they're all interconnected and so on. But these are considered end systems. They do something with the actual traffic, or they create the traffic and send it somewhere else. That's fine. They're obviously the one running the network as, but you need some kind of specialist equipment that makes sure that the data that gets generated gets delivered to the correct destination. So you need two things for that. Obviously, some way of communication, protocols, we'll get into that later. But you also need some way of connecting these things together. These are the links, and these are always the physical layer, regardless of whether it's actually something you can touch, anything physical or not. So a wireless link that goes over the ether, which is pretty much the term for it, it's still a physical thing, the air which you use to send something over. You need links in general, communication links, and you need these specialist devices, routers that send traffic from one, that know how to send traffic that comes in onto its next step. So I told you already about protocols. Protocols are what define the way in which this communication is done. So not only description, this is what you do, this is what the data looks like, but also this is what the data means. This is difficult to do correctly, and we will see that as time goes on. In other lectures, it's not as easy to completely describe every single instance or case you might run into with a protocol. So there's always that problem. And there are many of them, and they all have specific uses.
So the protocols that
become successful or
have become successful are almost always open protocols.
And they are open in the sense that they are, think of it like open source. Anyone can look at the protocol, see how it works. In other words, they can look at the description of the protocol, what the data is supposed to be looking like and how to interpret that data and so on. So they can implement that protocol into their own equipment. And that means if anyone can do this and it's a good protocol, it functions well, you'll get at some point more people will start using it, then more people will start using it, and so on and so on. And at one point it will push out the competing protocols that might not be open or not as function as well and so on. So there used to be many protocols before this. Well, there are still many protocols who are closed source, and you still see this going on. As soon as there's an open standard, a competing standard, there's a rapid uptake of people who are starting to adopt that, and sooner or later the closed protocols lose out. There are some exceptions that we're still stuck with, and that's mostly for lack of a good open alternative. Does anyone see which one I'm talking about?
Skype,
yeah. Skype is still closed. It's been reverse engineered by now, reasonably, not perfectly, but it's still pretty much closed, and there are no really really good alternatives that are as easy to use as Skype at the moment. There are some movements, but it's been a while. Skype has such an installed base that you can think of it like WhatsApp. Most people will use WhatsApp for the foreseeable future, even though much better alternatives are already there, much more secure alternatives, but there's such an installed base that it will take time for that to change. So, how do these protocols become standards? There's an internet engineering task force. What they do is they look at all these protocols. They have working groups. And these working groups consist of specialists from all fields, so both companies, universities, and so on. They come up with a protocol, I'm exaggerating a bit. They write down a standard, a proposed standard, a request for comments, and it gets sent out. And unless there are serious objections or serious problems, or so let's assume there are no massive groups of people who are annoyed with this suggestion and they think it's a bad idea and everyone agrees it's the best thing since sliced bread, this new protocol, at one point it gets accepted as a standard. So if you go and look online, and I would suggest to do that, these are easier to read than you might think, you will find RFCs for every imaginable protocol that is still in use today. And some of them are really, really old, these documents, but they describe protocols that we still use today. And you will see that it is annoyingly, some of the security problems that you run into are the result of these protocols being old and coming from an age where people didn't necessarily not think about security, but they didn't have to think about security at that point because it wasn't really an issue at the time on the internet. Most people were nice, there was no such thing as spam yet, and all these wonderful this glorious Eden before everyone's Bob and uncle got internet. So at the end of the day, these communication links and systems, hosts and routers, they all serve one purpose, and that's to deliver services to you. So this is actually the reason that Windows also calls it services. So a service can be anything, offering you web pages, voice over IP. This is what you want to do with a system at the end of the day. So, so I already said this, but a protocol can be described as follows. So if we have a discussion with each other, we use a protocol for that. And the easiest way of thinking about a protocol is what we're doing right now. I'm telling you things, and I'm telling you things in an English language, particularly. And the English language can be considered a protocol. So if I were to say hello to you, and you would answer een half gesneden brood, that would be a problem. Because at that point, you're communicating with a different protocol than I am. I might still understand you because I obviously speak the same protocol, the same language, but that is not the normal chain of events. So it's important to realize that a protocol is more than just describing what you can say. It is obviously also to describe when you can say certain things and what they mean. So it's not just what, it's also when, how, and so on. And this is where what I was hinting at when I said it's the same for, as it says, it's the same for machines. They have the same kind of protocols and the same idea behind it. The annoying thing is, you can probably imagine, if I say hello, there is an endless amount of things you could say in as a reply. So you might think that this is easy to cover with computers because there's only a limited amount of things a computer could answer. But if you start looking at these protocols, you will notice that there are thousands, millions of different replies that you might get, even from saying something simple or the equivalent of hello. And how you deal with that, to describe that all in one document, this size, the document, it's a problem. To clearly describe that, to properly deal with it in all situations. And a lot of security problems can stem from that. What do you do if there's a communication breakdown in the infrastructure? Okay, so the network core. I'm skipping over most of this because I assume you know this. So why is there this, to summarize it, did you have a question, Ron? Yes?
Wouldn't it be logic to blacklist all communications except for the ones that you would like to agree on accepting?
Mm-hmm. That's a good question, actually. So the question Ron asked was, wouldn't it be easier to blacklist all communications except the ones you're accepting? But the problem is not just that. And do you mean with blacklisting that you blacklist all protocols except?
For example, I worked with HTTP for my internship, mm-hmm. And I was told to do a bit of security as well. And my guide told me to blacklist any incoming calls except if they contain some authorization header, mm-hmm. or specific information.
Yeah. It's a good solution, but there's a problem with that. It's very hard to do that for every single part of your network because it implies something important. If you're able to do that, so let's assume you are able to blacklist everything except the traffic you want to see, it automatically implies that you know for, and I mean, this might be simple for you at home to give you an idea, but now imagine you need to do this for a multinational company that is running their own network. They have these different locations tied together in this, so they have roaming logins and so on. All these different kinds of traffic happen all over their company, and then they want to describe exactly what data should be where at any time and should be allowed to travel where, at what times, and so on. So you can imagine that it is, in practice, almost impossible to describe this. Or actually, it is impossible, not strictly mathematically impossible, but it's unworkable.
Yeah,
it's unrealistic.
I mean, like, in the description of the protocol itself, like, I mean, mm-hmm. I can't create an example, but if you were to say that the protocol that received messages should be the first 20 bits should be zeros or whatever.
Yes. That's what you're asking. So what about protocols? Why not define in protocols itself what is acceptable and what not? But then you have the problem that a lot of the protocols that we are still using today, they never thought of this problem at the time. So TCP, if you're particularly interested in... Oh, excuse me. If you're particularly interested in this, I would suggest that you look into the problem of covert channels. So let's assume that you are, for whatever reason, you think it's acceptable to, I don't see why not, you might be one, as a network administrator, you might want to ping certain systems on the outside world to check connectivity. Nothing special. But if you allow that, you already have a problem. A very simple problem. So what if I'm a nefarious bad guy hacker type and I want to exfiltrate information? So I like doing this, so I'm going to exaggerate. I'm a guest at DevCert. I see some interesting documents lying around on a USB stick. And there's no way I can take the USB stick outside, but I am there for a few days. So I'm thinking, what can I do? Hey, I can ping the outside world. So what could I do in this case? I make sure that when I go home on one of these days, I set up a server on the other side that receives my traffic, and I start pinging this server from within DevCert at this point. And I craft these ping packets in such a way that they are encoding the information that was in the document. Do you understand what I'm getting at? This is called a covert channel. And the problem is that nearly all protocols you can think of, if you start to think about how you could abuse these protocols, you will find ways to do that. So that's a very big problem. And this happens in practice. This is a very efficient, in the sense that it might take a long time, but a very efficient way of finding a method of exfiltrating data from networks. They almost always leak information.
Covert is just spelled
C-O. Yeah, covert, as in covert ops and so on, covert channels. This is a huge problem, and they try to get rid of this with IPv6 by explicitly defining what wasn't and was acceptable. Was acceptable traffic, how the IPv6 packets looked, what they looked like. And when I know that for a fact that when they started looking into it, they still found ways of doing it even with IPv6. So even at that level, you have a problem still. There are always so many ways, and as you can probably imagine, as the more complex a protocol gets, the higher the chance you will find one or more of these covert channels. So, good question. So that's a big problem. So, how did we end up with this internet structure? To go back to what I was talking about, it is mostly economical national policies, as it said. You have organizations such as ServNet or even big telecom providers such as UPC and KPN. Or even government, they run their own networks, and they do this because it's, in the end, they're of such a scale that it's cheaper for them to do it, and they want to have more access over what traffic goes over it and when. So you have at the largest scale, just get back to this, even at the largest scale, you sometimes have companies, even UPC is actually now one of these, thanks to their Aorta network in Europe, but ServNet is also a member of a federation. Even though ServNet is mostly regional, they are still member of a conglomerate, more or less, the GN network, of all these kinds of ServNet-like organizations throughout Europe, and they all interconnect these networks for academic research to each other. So this can shift, and it's mostly a question of policy, as it says, and economics. At some point, it's cheaper to do that, or desirable for other reasons. Okay. Yes.
Yes.
It's a good question. Yours asked, do these, I assume you mean all of them, KPN, and yeah, they have their own fiber, their own copper whenever needed. And particularly for ServNet, to give you an example, why ServNet or GNT or Torina, as they used to be called, why they do this is, so think about CERN. What happens at CERN?
Big data.
Yeah, big data, particularly from where? Big data.
The? From the molecule collision.
So. Yeah, the Large Hadron Collider. So whenever they do that, they have petabytes instantly of data that they need to do something with. They need to store it. Well, it's completely unrealistic to store everything on site, and it's undesirable because then the whole world doing research on that would have to connect to them. So what they do is they have this network of fiber throughout Europe specifically reserved for these experiments data. So what happens is when they have these collisions, one of the locations, one of the primary locations, is actually in the Netherlands, not far from here, on the Watergraafsmeerterrein, at the NICHEF, the Nederlands Instituut voor Kern- en Hoge Energiefysica, het FOM NICHEF. And they have huge data centers where they store part of this data, and huge interconnects. To give you an idea, it's in the order of 100 to 200 gigabits of uplink, and it's only reserved for dealing with that. You can imagine that if they would have to do this over the normal internet, that would be a huge problem, to say the least. They would block out certain, they would pretty much kick certain countries off the of the net entirely if they would start to route it over the normal links, in some cases, or at least companies or telcos along the way. So they have their own fiber for this. It's the same for KPN. So why do you think UPC has the aorta network? To ask you a question in return.
I think it's cheaper. So
yeah.
They don't have to use the network of other companies.
Yes, it's cheaper for them, and specifically because UPC is operating in many countries by now. They're in Sweden, Poland, etc. So at some point it became cheaper for them to build their own aorta network, as it's called, to interconnect all their different locations and their different areas of where they have customers, than to keep using other parties' links, which was expensive for them. Yes?
Are these locations actually linked through fiber, like miles and miles of cable?
Yes, sure.
Just like the HVA, where the streets actually open?
Yes. Yes, we literally have a fiber ring. It's not in the, in our case, however, it's not actually owned by the HVA, but we get it from KPN for a very low price because we're an academic organization. But yes, you will often hear the term dark fiber. It's only dark because it's not in use yet, and it's most of the time it's been put into the ground for later use or reserved for specific use. So yeah, as far as cables go. Transatlantic traffic is also literally just a cable that they roll out and it's lying on the floor. Usually as soon as they put it down on the ocean floor, there's about five submarines from Russia, England, the US, probably also the Netherlands by now with our subs, and we're all tapping these things, listening for all the traffic we want, but... that's a different. What AM6 does is... The point behind these, what are they called? There's a term for that. These internet exchanges, pretty much, is that they offer one centralized location where all these companies can hook up, so they're very close to each other, and they don't have to, instead of all having to make cables to each other, they all only need to go to one internet exchange to exchange traffic with each other.
But AM6 doesn't go across Atlantic?
No. No. There are many of these internet exchanges. There's a huge one in New York, and it was burned to the ground about 14 years ago, and it's been rebuilt now. It was actually on Wall Street. So, this is what you, this is, it's actually what you're looking at here. There are these major hubs where most of the traffic goes to. Microsoft is actually operating a huge one. It's called ConExion. At least it used to be called Connexion, and Microsoft largely built and financed this, if I remember correctly, because as you can probably imagine, let me ask you a funny question. What do you think most of the traffic is in the HVA network? What does it consist of? What do you think our internet link is used for the most? You think downloading? Gaming? You're actually way off. It's not torrenting and so on. I know it's popular, but...
Windows updates.
Yes, very good. It's actually Windows updates. Very good. Gold star. Now, you won't believe it, but that's actually what most of the traffic is. Yes?
Let's say a country is in war with another country. What
yes.
are people keeping them from attacking those lines?
Nothing. And you saw this, that's a good question, and you saw this happening. With Syria, you saw it happening with Libya, you saw it happening with Iraq, Iran, as they want to, and whenever they fancy, the governments there usually have tight control over these locations and uplinks and so on, they just disconnect.
It's such an incredible length of covering now, also in international waters.
They also suspect that some of the outages around that area was Israel actually cutting undersea cables, going to these countries like Jordan and so on, countries they are not very friendly with, to put it nicely, cutting these cables temporarily, installing listening devices, and then reconnecting them. Whenever you see these things in the news, make a note of it, remember. It usually has to do with this kind of, it's usually these kinds of incidents behind it. For whatever reason, they're upset with each other, and it happens. But it can be even for something simple as, I don't know if you followed the whole discussion about Netflix in the US and Comcast, the worst internet provider in the world, voted year after year. But if you follow that, Comcast is doing something similar. They're not literally cutting the cord to Netflix, but they're making it so slow in order to extort money from Netflix. That's what it boils down to. So they can do it for economic reasons. They can do it for political reasons. They can do it for, well, I don't know if war is politics, but sure. And yeah, well, everything is always under attack. You need to assume that as well. So I have to look at a lot of the equipment here and make sure nothing goes wrong. And it's just a non-stop barrage of Chinese, Russians, Ukrainians, who are doing nothing but attack us. And you would say, well, it's probably just people with infected systems. But if I start looking at where the traffic is coming from, it's not unusual to find universities, government systems. I'm trying to keep a checklist. The only thing I haven't seen so far is North Korea, pretty much, but surprisingly. But that's the reality. I mean, internet has become a core infrastructure for most of the business and everything we do, so it's a viable target. And it's actually a prime target, I would say. There's a reason why everyone is... We have GCHQs, NSAs, and their primary task is dealing with this stuff still. SIGINT, finding out what's going on, and making sure shit doesn't hit the fan. So, so whenever you see these problems, delay, loss, what are the possible reasons? This is an important sheet. I left it in because the original sheets are much more extensive. I really want you to learn this and make sure you can reproduce it at a whim. If I wake you up in bed in the middle of the night and ask you what are the four reasons for problems with loss and delay, you instantly know what the answer is. This is an important one. So, it can be that there are simply too many packets coming in. And you'll see, if you're smart, you're probably noticing that we're going towards security problems already. There are more packets coming in than the link they're supposed to go out over can handle. So, let me ask you, the packets are queuing up, so they have to wait longer and longer. The queue gets bigger and bigger, and at some point they don't even get accepted anymore. Any idea what we're going towards? Yes, distributed denial of service. The whole idea behind distributed denial of service is this. Simply flooding your target with so many packets or so much data that the target becomes unreachable, and legitimate traffic is not sent over anymore. A big problem. There are always bottlenecks somewhere in a network, as you know. So there's a delay. That's one reason, possible reason for delay. This is also, of course, to come back to what I said earlier, the reason Comcast is hated. They were doing this to the Netflix traffic, making sure that the outgoing link to Netflix was so slow that people were having problems watching anything at all. So there are four reasons in total that this can happen. Four general reasons. Nodal processing. And what is nodal processing? These routers are still computers. They are very simple computers, and they need to do something very simple, actually, otherwise they wouldn't be so fast, but they still need to do some processing. And what processing is that? Are we talking about? They need to figure out, if they get traffic, is it for me? And if yes, where is it supposed to go? They will have one or more other links to send this traffic out over. So it implies that they need to do something with the traffic. So if they are not quick enough in doing that, you will also experience slowdown. And you can probably understand there's always some slowdown, hopefully in the area of nanoseconds or less, if you're lucky, if you have good equipment. Perfect. You won't really notice it in the total delay you're experiencing sending some traffic to your destination. But it happens. There can be queuing delay. So this is the congestion story from the previous slide. If there's too much queued up and the queue gets bigger and bigger, the delay will increase and increase. We have transmission delay. Very simply, even an outgoing link, a link still has a certain capacity. It simply cannot handle more traffic than it was designed for, or it operates at, or however you want to describe it. So if it has to send more traffic than it can in 1 second, that's why you have this, see, bits and bits per second, a simple calculation, the traffic has to wait, the total amount of traffic. And finally, propagation delay. It sounds similar to transmission delay, but it isn't. Propagation delay has to deal simply with physical limitations, physics, as in physics in this case. So in Dutch, natuurkunde, for those of you wondering. So what is the most obvious way that we see this propagation delay? And I'm sure many of you watch TV. Copper line, you won't really notice it. Over copper line, it's still the speed of light. But even the speed of light has limitations. What is the... How do you know... Sorry?
Wouldn't the copper burn out?
Yeah, exactly. Yours here at the front said a satellite link. So what am I talking about? Satellite link is the answer. Why do you notice that there is a limit to... Well, there's a limit to the light speed as well. How do you notice this with satellite links? I already gave you a hint with watching TV.
Oh, you mean like with news reporters when they
yes.
ask a question
yes.
and there's a delay before they answer?
Exactly. It's a Peter Damkur in Moscow, usually, wherever he is. And it's, Peter, how is the situation on the Red Square? Yes, thank you for asking. That's what you see happening. It's literally, there's a limit to the light speed, and it has to go to the satellite, go back down to Earth. That's the limitation. And you can actually notice this as well. If you can try, there's also a limitation, a noticeable limitation, if you have your cell phone, call your neighbor. So walk up to your neighbor, your friend, call him on the cell phone. And if you're talking to him, you're standing face to face, you will notice a small but noticeable delay in before the what you just said into the phone reaches him. There are just limitations to this as well. So you will always have some kind of delay. So make sure you know these.
But isn't that more part of transmission? Because
yeah.
I thought propagation is a loss due to restrictions in space, like or in the atmosphere.
You mean that the satellite delay is due to loss? Packet loss?
Friction because of space dust or in the atmosphere?
That's a good question. Does the delay have to do with friction, space? Actually, the answer is no. The only effect that will have is that the bandwidth, the capacity will go down. The more interference you have, the more time you will be spending on reconstructing, error correction, and so on. So the link speed goes down. It's comparable to... for those of you who have ADSL, the further you are from the phone company, the lower the speed gets because you suffer more and more from interference in your copper wiring. So that's what space dust and all these other stuff will do to you, atmospheric interference. You can actually notice the problem with atmospheric interference if you have a GPS. If you have time, when it's a beautiful sunny day outside, go stand outside, turn on the GPS, just hold the stopwatch and see how long it takes before it gets a lock. So out of the box, clean boot, nothing else. And then try it again on a cloudy, rainy day. You will see that it will take longer. It has to do, once again, with interference in this case. Even though the lock might still be as accurate at the end of the day of the GPS signal. So, does that answer your question? Okay. Any other questions so far? No. Great. We will have a break at some point. So you can actually do some predictions. If you do a little bit of math, this is nothing other than doing a multiplication and a division. You can do some predictions about what will happen. So the A is the arrival rate of packets. The L is the packet length, so that's why you multiply these two together to get the amount of traffic that is coming in, the size of the traffic, and you divide that by the link bandwidth, so how much can the link handle. So if you do this calculation, you can simply say, so if that, the closer this gets to zero, so if the either the amount of packets is very small, or the packet length is very small, or the R is very big, the bandwidth, the chance that the traffic has to wait, or the delay it will have, is small, because it will get closer and closer to zero. So the closer you get to the one, the slower it will go, for the same reason. Because at one point, the link bandwidth and the packet length, the packet length and the average packet arrival rate divided by the link capacity will be equal numbers and get closer to one. And that's also why this last one means, oops, now we're going to have a problem. Because if you get higher than one, obviously the R or the LA is bigger. The LA is bigger than the R, or the R is too small to handle the traffic coming in. So the work starts building up. The link is simply not quick enough, the link bandwidth, to handle the incoming traffic. So, how do you see this real delay? I assume this is all well known for you. You can trace route, and you will see actually what the delays are that you experience sending the traffic to a location when you can determine yourself over the internet. So, I don't know if Irshad has done this with you, but I would like to ask you, if you've never tried this, please do so and try trace routing, for instance, to China or to the US. And if you're clever and you can do a little bit of math, you can see how much time is spent. You can make some estimates on how much time is spent on these different aspects. You will notice, for instance, that if you trace route to the US, you will see a huge spike in the delay. And that spike is purely because the traffic at one point has to cross the Atlantic to get there. If you go to China, most of the traffic usually goes to the US, through the US at this point, if you want to go to China. So you will not only see a huge increase in delay when it crosses the Atlantic, but another one when it crosses the Pacific to Japan and so on. So one of the questions I always used to ask when I taught this as a separate class is, can you make any predictions about the bandwidth when you look at the delay? Can you say anything about the bandwidth, so the speed of a link, if you look at the delay?
Yes, you can. With the equation you just gave us, if you do a calculation, you can see, is it closer to zero? Then you can say, well, the bandwidth has to be at least this.
So if you see the delay, you only see the delay that your traffic is experiencing, can you then say anything about the bandwidth? Yeah, you're missing one variable. You actually can't. You're missing a variable for that. So whenever you download something from Japan, there's no reason it would be very slow if the links are not, if the links are not experiencing one of these, close to one or over one, there should be no problem. It might actually go as quick If there's literally no link along the way that is over capacity at that moment, you will get the maximum speed possible as delivered by that system in Japan that you're contacting. So make sure you understand the difference. This is the one of the reasons I always used to ask this question. Make sure you understand the difference between delay and bandwidth. They are two completely different things. They are unmistakably intertwined, usually, but they are separate things. So try that if you haven't. So packet loss. As I said before, at one point a queue can get full. There's more traffic coming in than the outgoing link can handle. So what do you do with the traffic that comes in and there's simply no room in the queue anymore? The answer might surprise you, but what a router does is just, drop it. It disappears into nothing. So is that a problem that we're losing traffic? That's a good answer, actually. Rowan, what did you say?
Not with TCP.
That's a very specific answer, but you strike at the heart of the matter. It is not a problem if the information you're sending over that link is encoded in such a way that you can detect that you've lost information. Generically worded, you can solve that problem at a different stage, at a different level. This packet loss. And TCP is a good example of a protocol that does that. And pretty much the prime example, I guess. So you might decide to retransmit or not at all if it's not important. You might also be happy and not care about losing this packet for whatever reason. So throughput, as I said already, it is something different. And the throughput you can get between a sender and receiver, the maximum throughput is always the size of the smallest link along the way. So if, for instance, let's say there's only three links between me and you, and I have a gigabit, you have a gigabit, and between us there's a 28K8 modem, we're out of luck. The best speed we're going to get is 28K8 between the two of us. So what does that mean? That a lot of the importance of getting good internet speeds and making the internet work for everyone in a nice way is making sure that we use these slow links as little as possible and route efficiently around these links that are congested and so on, that we circumvent these problems whenever possible. So I'll skip this one. See the bottleneck link, as we found out already. Some examples. shall we take a short break? Okay, so we've had about almost 1.5 hours. We'll take a short break, about 10 minutes, so I'll see you at 10 to 12. Can you stop the recording again, temporarily? Welcome back. So let's continue, or round up rather. So I already told you, Rowan actually made a very good comment about you can solve the problem with packet loss at a higher level. And that's a nice segue into the aspect of protocol layers. And the thing is, networks are very complex, as we saw. There's hosts, routers, different links, lots of applications, protocols, different hardware, software, and so on. So, and coming from a historical perspective, this was a pretty big challenge. Before they started to think in layers, and we'll get into the internet stack and the OC stack later, in a few slides, but it used to be that all these different pieces of equipment, all this different software, tried to do everything at the same time. So they were huge, bulky machines or pieces of software that tried to do everything, succeeded or failed miserably, probably the latter a lot of the time. So this was an unworkable situation. it started off with the best of intentions, as most things do, but it wasn't a really a viable way of continuing to do everything in one device, every responsibility for all these different types of usage, and so on. So they started thinking, how can we solve this problem structurally? And that's where the idea of the protocol stacks come in. So this is the Internet Protocol Stack. Some of you are well familiar with the OSI model as well. It adds two layers, that's about it. So what is the point of this? You split the different parts of a network into different layers with their own responsibilities. So what does that mean? The physical layer is literally the bits on the wire. The some kind of voltage differential or whatever the means of transportation is, maybe it's light pulses or who knows what we're using, or EM radiation, or it could be wireless as well on the physical layer. And that's the responsibility of that layer. So the link layer deals with data, well, it pretty much says it deals with data transfer between different network elements on a very low level. The network is responsible for routing, so figuring out how to get the information from one part to another part, and hopefully in an efficient and nice way. The transport layer is responsible for two end systems, usually two processes on these end systems actually exchanging the data, and you have the application that from there takes the data it is interested in out and uses it for whatever service it's offering you as an end user. So frequently we ask questions in our exam that say, for instance, they pose the question, where does, let's say, an image file belong? It might seem like a weird question, but let's talk about a JPEG file. Can you also place that somewhere on this stack? It's a bit of a sneaky question, but you can actually, particularly if you're well familiar with the OSI model. What does the OSI model have extra on top of the internet model? The session and presentation layer. Very good. Now think about those two layers, and they are usually combined into one for the internet protocol stack, but let's for a second assume we have these two layers, the session and the protocol presentation layers. Where would you place an image file? Sorry? Please raise your hand. The presentation, why? Does it belong in the presentation layer?
It's presented to the user.
Actually, no, that's not what presentation is about. You need to think about presentation layer in the meaning of representation. The data is represented in a certain way. In this case, an image format describing how the image is supposed to be interpreted and so on. XML, SOAP related things, all go to the presentation layer for that reason. So the session layer, does anyone know an example of the session layer? Of a session layer protocol?
In the socket?
Sorry?
A connection between two computers?
No, that's not really on the session layer. A session is a bit more. SSL, very good example. Because you, the secure socket layer, it implies that you have an encrypted, well, session, it's not nice to use the same word in the answer, but you have a session between two systems that is encrypted for its duration. But there are other examples. Has anyone heard of single sign-on systems? What kind of protocols are used for that? I'm looking at you, Joran. Who's doing the Muppet Labs project? No, but they're usually implemented with certain protocols, single sign-on systems. You get a session token There are protocols for that. No, 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 not HTTP, SSS. Okay, well, I'll leave it up to you then. Look into this. There are, you can, to get back to my point, for every protocol there is, in generally speaking, protocols always belong on one, hopefully one, sometimes more than one layer. There are weird exceptions, notably Telnet. Depending on how you use Telnet, it is either on the presentation layer, on or on the application layer, oddly enough. But generally, you want to have a protocol belong on one layer because it's supposed to be responsible for only one of these things. And this is very simple. In the sense that there's a very simple reasoning behind it. It is to prevent this feature creep, to put it in nice terms. If a protocol is supposed to be responsible for everything, it becomes huge, unwieldy, bulky, prone to errors, and so on. So there's the whole point of these models is that you have these more or less interfaces. The protocol that is on a higher level gives its information to the level above it, and it can depend on the layer beneath it to hand its data to and get it from. And so that protocols on a certain layer don't need to know how these layers around them work, on top of them or below of them. So, I already told you, presentation, as you see, encryption can be there because encryption also implies that the data is represented in a certain way. Compression, it's not really the same as encryption. I would recommend the OSI model because it's a little bit more comprehensive because of these two layers. I always talk about the eighth layer as well, on top of the application layer. And that is the user, exactly. You're also responsible for interpreting, taking information from the application and understanding it, and taking what you know and giving it in an understandable way to the application. There's also a translation happening there. So that's what it's look like, and how this is what it looks like, and how is this even possible? Because it's encapsulated. Very simply, every time you go down a layer, the data gets extra administrative information around it for that layer it is handed down to. So as a user, you give it in, you enter something into the application, your message, hopefully. The application gives it to the transport layer. And the transport layer adds its own header, which it needs to do its work, pretty much. It's defined in the protocol. And so on. So it's a nice idea, and it works very well in practice, this model. There is one downside to it. What is the downside?
Overhead.
It adds overhead for every layer. Well, the thing is, the protocols are designed in such a way that the overhead is minimal or easy to deal with, luckily, so you don't really notice it that much. But for those of you who have worked, for instance, with IPv6, and IPv6 tunnels, you will start to run into weird effects because of overhead problems and all this encapsulation, etc., etc. You get very weird effects with certain links saying, hey, this is too much data, I'm missing part of the header, I cannot. You lose data in somewhere along the way and you can't figure out why. It is not ideal, but it works well in practice. So, data gets sent, at one point it gets sent over the physical link, it comes back to a different router. The router only has to look at the parts that are relevant for the router. That's the nice thing about the layered model, which means the router is simple to build and efficient. It gets sent at one point to your computer, and your computer just starts stripping off the headers, handing it up to layers until it ends up in the application and is presented to you as the user. So, I will make one point about something you said or asked earlier on. You asked about the problem, can we not just blacklist everything? You can see that the complexity problem quickly starts to rear its head. You very quickly have the problem that you need to start blacklisting every variant, type, sequence, or rather you need to make sure that you know every sequence, variant, type of traffic that needs, that is legitimate and comes in. So it's not that easy unless you live in a, unless you're lucky enough to live in a situation where you have full control and know exactly what happens. Otherwise, you never can be quite sure what to expect. And blanket blacklisting can be risky then. So, a summary. So, some basic stuff, and you see what the security problems are with infrastructure. This is only basic information. I'm going to switch to the second presentation after this. What I would recommend is, if you have this book still, is dig up the old Kuros and Ross, the mini book. Do some of you have these first two chapters still? Or have the complete book? If you have it, read up on it again. I've skipped over a lot of information because we need to catch up. And reread everything so you have a good foundation in for the rest of the courses. So I'm going to quickly open the second one, I hope. Are there any questions so far? Feel free to ask. Okay. Hello. Okay. So, as I said, the learning goals again. Nothing at all, just a few things. You can find these CISSP areas of knowledge on the VLO. If you haven't found them already, you can find them and take a look at what we're doing, so you know what is covered in each of these lessons. So, we're going to switch to wireless security. Some of you, if you have been paying attention in the practical classes, you're already busy doing this with Wireshark, etc. So, wireless area networks, you have them in two variants, WWAN or, well, just outright WAN, wireless LAN. Generally, when we speak about wireless LAN, we're talking about something you have at home, or even something we have here at the HVA is a wireless LAN. It operates within the building, even though it's pretty much a ton of access points operating as one. You have nice transmission rates, a lot of problems with interference, unfortunately. That's just the frequency it operates at. But there are also, wide area wireless access. It's not very common, I think, in the Netherlands. We have, I know a few people who are very active with ham radio and similar things. There are a lot of specialist organizations, but I don't think in the Netherlands we have these WiMAX or wide area wireless access yet to offer internet. I think there are several providers looking at using this to offer internet in remote places in the Netherlands, you know, farms or something that are way too far from any telecom hub, or they don't have cable either, and satellite is simply too slow for them for various reasons. But I don't think we have a lot of them. There's not really that much remote areas in the Netherlands. It is very popular, this kind of access, in countries, certain countries in Africa, for instance, where this is a problem, where they need to get connectivity to remote places. They will use these. You will also find things like a microwave, point-to-point or point-to-multipoint links in that area. They are generally still within a city, though. There's a couple on the energy power plant here in Amsterdam. And they cover parts of the center of Amsterdam, for instance, microwave radiation. But it's, you don't see it that often. Yes?
Actually, we're testing right now some application of the WAN in areas of where we do our missions. We use balloons to set up an antenna to provide the whole base and the forward operating bases with some kind of network. Not specifically internet, but some of our own.
Is it a microwave?
It's microwave.
Microwave, okay. Point to point, point to multipoint, or?
Point to multipoint.
Okay. Cool, yeah, very good use for it. Do you still use the satellite dishes on these mobile communications units, these trucks as well, for uplink. They're nice
things.
I had a tour of one of them. They're a bit warm inside, but they are nice. Okay, so yeah, but the weird thing is there's whether or not you will see this in practice, of course, there's a specific use for them in the case of defense, but telecom providers are very motivated, of course, to offer this kind of coverage. They would rather have the customers on existing infrastructure than having to roll out new. And so I don't know if we're going to see this en masse for public use in the Netherlands, to be honest. We'll see. They keep talking, and there are a lot of companies that keep talking about, yes, let's have nationwide Wi-Fi coverage, but I'm not sure we really will see that. Okay. Okay, and like I said, I actually told you about this before. Metropolitan access networks are usually between these two sizes. Frequently used to cover cities, campuses, new stations, and so on. Basically, larger areas where, in the case of campuses, they have multiple locations they want to combine into one. Same thing with new stations and so on. Okay, so different topologies. How can you organize a network? This is mostly for information. If you're used to seeing Ethernet, it's kind of like this. Everyone is on their own link on a central switch. It used to be like this, where you're all on the same link and you're all fighting for attention. That used to be a hub. There are different methods of combining them. Most of the time it's a hierarchical topology with one or more redundant parts. But in some cases you might actually still find these or these as well. For instance, there are industrial. Do you know Corus? The Hoge ovens? These are factories that cannot go offline. You cannot just turn off a factory. They can't just, let's just stop melting iron and stop working. And you can't just shut off these machines. At one point, they installed networks there based on old technology, DECnet and so on, that is still in use, that they still need equipment for as well as a result, but they can never really turn that off because it's needed for the systems control and so on, SCADA systems. And often you will find that these older styles of networks, bus and ring topologies, are still in use at these organizations, heavy industry and so on. Okay, so physical security. Now we're gonna get into the security. I like XKCD. If you don't know it, it's time to start reading it. It's very funny. I'll let you see the comic for a few seconds. Most of the time when we talk to students, they're like, yes, let's see if we can crack this encryption. And I usually show them this comic from Randall Monroe. It's usually easier to attack the implementation of cryptography than the actual cryptography. That's the most important thing I want you to remember. And this goes for all physical security. There's no exception. Another way of thinking about it is cryptography or security, which is, in this case it's the same, it's only as good as its weakest link. Let's put it very simply. If you have the best locks on the door in the world, if someone holds the door open for the person after him, it's pointless to have brilliant locks with fingerprints. If the person just holds the door open, what use was it? It's only as strong as the weakest link. That's what you need to think about. And that's also the point of this comic. Why not just attack the person who knows the key until he gives it to you, rather than attacking the trying to crack it in some way? They're trying to put this into law, actually, that you have to give your key. So, you have different aspects of physical security. Logical security, I hope it's readable, but even for the people in the back. But it says protects computer-based data from software-based and communication-based threats. What do you need to think about that? What do you need to think about there? You want to make sure that, thinking in terms of physical security, that you might still have brilliant security and the software and communication is superb, but if someone can simply attack it by plugging into the network or whatever, and he's suddenly a member of the network and can see this data, so he's a logical member for whatever reason. You can probably imagine certain situations where this would be quite realistic, for instance at a company. If nobody is checking that you're not plugging in your own device and making a copy of everything, you're out of luck. Physical security, very simple. The information systems that contain all this information, it's nice if these things are all related, as you will see. It's perfect. Let's see, they are high-grade systems, very expensive. They encrypt everything on them. And I'm, once again, a nefarious hacker type. I just look, oh, they're standing over there. Next time the server room door is open, I walk in, I just take the machine out of the rack and walk outside with it. Very simple attacks, in this case, literally physical security, but still very realistic. And this happens. And this happens a lot. Government organizations, companies, leaving USB keys with critical data lying around, leaving laptops lying around. And it's luckily, so far, there have not been any, as far as I know, or as far as they might admit, huge data breaches as a result of this. But imagine if bad guy, Mr. Bad Guy Hacker got access to a laptop that contained critical data, he realized that it was critical data, you can probably imagine what kind of an incident this would create. I saw you had a question.
Yeah, well, actually a really nice example of this is last year I had a lecture from Bart Jacobs, and he has a known security firm. Mm-hmm. And they were hired by the government to hack into their systems. Well, that was so good secure that they couldn't go into it from the outside on the software. So in the period in December, they dressed up as Sinterklaas. And they walked through the gate.
I can see where this is going.
And, the guy at the gate, because he's well secured with weapons and all, he said, yeah, well, do you have an appointment? No, Sinterklaas doesn't have to make an appointment. And they walked through.
Brilliant.
His gear under his dress. And they actually walked in and hacked him in their way into the...
Brilliant, yes. Yeah, that's pen testing specifically, penetration testing, that's a part of it, yes?
This is how they spread Stuxnet, I believe. They dropped USB keys in front of the firm.
They used the Trojan horse principle, literally a Trojan horse principle where they tricked employees. They think they tricked employees or people who had access to the plant computers to at one point plug in devices containing the malware, correct. Yeah, that's a good example. And I would like to challenge you. I'm sure most of you have jobs on the side, as I said previously. Why not walk around the office and see how many people have post-it notes under their keyboards, on their monitors, with their password on it? And even if they don't, I challenge you, look at their desk. They usually have a photo of their wife, significant other, loved ones. Try figuring out what their names are, birth dates, and you can probably guess their passwords. It's usually very easy to do these things. And it's just by walking around and poor physical security. If you're good with this kind of stuff, like a preventive security, so not only pen testing the other side of it as well, this is the first thing you start looking for and telling the company, this is not good, what you're doing. Employees need to be instructed better not to do these things. Okay, premises security. Obviously, this is about very relevant for defense, of course. You don't want people running around a military base uncontrolled or any military office without any checking beforehand. This is why any government security or security-related Office in General has all these screenings beforehand as well. Before you even are considered of being let into an office, you get screened. And this can vary in extensiveness, the screening, right up until the point that they know almost everything is stored somewhere. But that all has to do with, to a large part, with this. First of all, you want to weed out the bad guys as soon as you can, because the biggest danger, as you can probably see, one of the biggest danger is just someone being physically on site. Even if he or she doesn't have the chance to take that server with them, if they can start disconnecting cables at random because something is lying loose, you don't know what someone will do in these cases. So, okay. So this is here are a lot of aspects with premises security. Everything, not just from like I said, the example of service, but they give examples such as environmental protection. Think about everything from how to protect against lightning strikes to maybe you want a server room to be completely disconnected from the outside world, except with an air conditioning system, but everything is with an overpressure system, so you can't have a gas attack in the server room, and all these things you need to think about with physical security. It's very complex, and you need to think about everything. Okay, so physical security, what it boils down to, you want the physical assets, everything from the servers to routers, all these components that we talked about, you want to protect them, the devices itself, and the information on it. And you need to do two things for that. Not only do you need to prevent damage to them due to factors that you might not even have control over, natural disasters or whatever, which means, it can be as simple as an accident on site for whatever reason to that lightning strike I just described, or maybe even war breaks out. If you're building a data center for a company and it's in a Syria right now, you're going to have some interesting requirements for that data center. I can guarantee you that. It also means that you need to do this. You need to think about people who are actively out to get you and your equipment. So misuse, damage. So misuse also covers the leaking of the information. It can be vandalism. I just gave you the example. Don't forget, someone might be as crazy as just starting to unplug cables because he's upset, he had a bad performance review from his boss and he goes crazy. It can be theft of equipment, the five-finger discount principle. Copying, theft of services, or maybe it's an employee who thinks, hey, we have a lot of processing power, let's start Bitcoin mining. And you laugh, but this happens at the university here. We've had multiple incidents over many years, I must say, of students who thought it would be funny to do SETI at home, Bitcoin mining. Why not see, as you can probably see, we consider that at least questionable morals if you start doing that. But it happens. You need to deal with that. You need to detect it. You need to prevent it as much as you can. You need to detect it. And then you need to have some kind of system in place to stop it, or limit the effects, mitigation. So there's environmental threats and human caused threats, and those are covered by risk assessment. So you can see there's some overlap in some parts with Carla's lectures. And there's the technical threats. So the technical threats, you need to think about the layer model again. And this is often forgotten, but you can also have technical threats that are on the physical level. If I take a Ethernet cord and I make a normal power connector on the other end and I plug it in and I plug the other end into a power socket, I'm going to most likely blow out at least some network equipment on the other side. It is a crazy attack, let's be honest, a very vandalism-oriented one, but it can happen. And this is an example of someone of me doing it intentionally, being the various bad guy again, but it can also happen by accident. People plugging in the wrong equipment into the wrong socket. It's a realistic thing you need to think of. You can have power utility problems. Once again, here in the Netherlands, we're used to having power being on all the time. I can also tell you, last Friday, we had a massive power outage here in this province. I think about 150,000 households were without power for about 20 minutes. But we're over, let's be honest, over, generally speaking, the Netherlands is very reliable. But once again, let's assume you're making that data center in Syria. How are you going to deal with this? Or even in the US, this is a problem. And it's not because the US doesn't necessarily have a big power infrastructure, but some parts are incredibly remote, which means that they only have, for instance, one line. There is no redundancy in their power grid towards certain towns or remote areas. So if something goes wrong, there's a lightning strike somewhere in the area, you get huge overvoltage temporary on the line, or noise, or even a brownout can happen. And that's just power problems. Sorry.
What's a brownout?
Brownout is under voltage. Usually it happens because other parts of a grid, there's a failure in other parts of the grid, which causes power that is on other parts of the grid to be diverted to compensate, which means the overall voltage will drop. Or there's suddenly a huge, basically it comes down to, if you know just basic physics, if there's suddenly a huge power draw coming from somewhere, it will also cause a drop. It can cause a drop. You need to be able. This is why the problem with people, all these solar cells and people who are now delivering to the grid, it's a big challenge for companies like TenneT and Liander who are operating the grids in the Netherlands, and they're similar, of course, in the rest of Europe. It's a big challenge for them to rework and redesign a lot of the power management systems so they can cope with all these spikes. If it suddenly starts to become very sunny weather in Bavaria, I don't know if you've ever been in Bavaria in Germany recently, but nearly every farm is completely covered in solar cells. So imagine if there suddenly the sun comes through there and all these solar cells start producing power. They need to be able to cope with those spikes. And that's a big challenge. And that's also something you need to cope with if you're in a company. How do you do this? So usually you will find that data centers or critical infrastructure is protected by specialist power supplies, specialist generators, and this kind of equipment that has to deal with this. So that's only one thing, but that's only the whole problem of power itself. So electromagnetic interference. All electronics create this. And as if you look at the labels, there's usually an FCC sticker, or there used to be, that says this equipment is designed to receive any kind of radiation, or sorry, EM radiation, without blah blah problems, etc. It all has to do with this problem, because if you emit radiation and you accept radiation, the radiation you accept also causes effects on the equipment. I'm sure some of you have seen, who has seen Ocean's 11, the movie? So, what am I referring to? An EMP, yeah, an electromagnetic pulse. It creates a huge blast of EM radiation, which means that all unshielded equipment is likely to go bust. And if you haven't seen Ocean's 11, you've probably heard of Chernobyl. It was a huge problem there as well. At one point, one of the major reasons they started having people clean the roof, etc., from all the trash was because all computer equipment they were using, these robots, which, if they were lucky, it operated maybe for an hour or so, because before the radiation completely destroyed the electronics in these machines. So that's a big problem, because nearly everything has some kind of computer in it. So if you will look at modern military equipment that is designed to deal with these EM blasts, they are hugely shielded as a result to protect against this. And not only that, the equipment they use is very, very different from a normal processor you will find in a computer most of the time, extra shielded as well. The space shuttle is out of commission right now, but the processor and the computer equipment in the space shuttle was never upgraded for the same reason. Because if they were using modern equipment in the space shuttle, it would die rather quickly because of, well, you're out of the atmosphere, so you have tons more radiation that damages it as a result. It all has to do with this problem of electromagnetic interference, and it gradually destroys equipment. Once again, it is stuff you have to deal with in physical security. Okay, so some of the technical, I already gave some hints, these technical threats are weaponized in reality. They can be and they have been. So grid outages, intentional or not. Power line cuts, boils down to the same thing. Malware, subtle changes in the PLC, programmable logical logic controllers, to intentionally disrupt the workings of these usually industrial machinery. So someone already said something about Stuxnet. That is a good example of people doing that. Instead of attacking the data, just slowly changing the physical behavior or influencing the physical behavior of the systems to get what you want. And the worst case, of course, is EMP. If something like that ever goes off, we'll have a huge problem, actually. Or if we have a massive solar flare, the same thing can happen. We'll also have a huge problem. It's extremely difficult to protect against. And you will often see that if you're doing, if you're writing disaster recovery plans, which is all part of business continuity management, and Carla will tell you a lot more, it is best effort, but it's hard to, or it's usually you don't even try to deal with the things that are outside of your direct control because it's pointless. The only thing you can deal with that is building in redundancy everywhere. At some point, things are expendable in the sense that they, the cost of replacing them is less than trying to protect against every possible attack you might suffer from. So there's maybe a best effort, depending on the worth of the information and the systems that are there. But at some point, the cost of that will be way more than just replacing it or having a second set of it somewhere else. Okay, so what can you do? Physical security prevention and mitigation measures. If you're dealing with these environmental threats or technical threats, and most of this stuff you've probably seen already once in a data center, I'm assuming. Fire and smoke, you have smoke detectors, automated extinguishing. I'm putting in dangerous, question mark. I'll come to the other points later. Why is this dangerous, question mark?
It uses some kind of gas, I don't remember which one. Or water damages equipment.
Well, you can't use water, exactly. That's a good point. You don't want to do that. It, particularly not with all this electricity flying around, yes?
Right. That protection that sucks away all the oxygen, right?
Yes, that's actually the point. It's not that they use a gas, per se. The gas itself they use is argon, usually, or something similar. And argon is what, a?
Noble gas.
A noble gas, exactly. Which means it doesn't react with anything, which is, means it's perfect for stopping a fire, as you could probably guess. And it's not that you, well, you can breathe argon, it has no effect on you, but you won't get any oxygen. It pushes out all the oxygen, exactly. So you suffocate. That's what happens. So data centers where they have these systems, they usually have these very encouraging signs on the wall. If in case of fire, you have 30 seconds to evacuate. And they, the technical engineers on site are very subtly but strongly encouraged to not finish what they're doing when a fire happens, but really make it out in 30 seconds. Or they will never make it out. It's the end of the line if that happens. So it all has advantages and disadvantages as well. So if you're in a data center, this might be perfect if you have a data center on location. But what are you going to do if you're a mobile, maybe you are a mobile communication unit? How do you deal with that, with fire and smoke? That will be difficult. Bring your entire argon installation with you. Could be possible in the same truck. But then we just blow up the argon. We aim for the argon tanks. And the rest will probably, due to the explosion, it all has upsides and downsides. And you can't, as you can probably see where this is going, it's hard to protect against everything. especially once you start taking into consideration the outside factors or environmental things you have no control over. So, water, which is actually an interesting problem in the Netherlands, because the Amsterdam Internet Exchange, it's not on the ground floor for a reason of the building it's in. I'm not sure it's even high enough even then not to be covered by water. I doubt it, actually. But these are really, really big problems in this country. How do you deal with that if we have a flood? Other threats, pest control. I've seen, you won't believe the things I've seen or heard of over the course of these years, but I've seen people design data centers where they had super secure data centers, but the they were hooking it up, the air conditioning systems, to the outside world without filters. And I don't know if you know how air conditioning works, but that is probably not a good idea to do that. You could just go to the air circulation system and put some nice things in there until the air conditioner broke and everything overheats. And that's the end of the data center. Just the stupidest design decisions you can think of, you can make, but with potentially massive impact. Okay, so what do you usually see with power? I named a few already. You have power supplies. For small systems or limited use, or limited companies, limited in size, if it's company-wise, you will have something like a UPS, which is either flat out just a huge battery or a generator of some kind. Critical equipment, in general, you want to connect this to one of those systems. You can use a lot of filters and shielding within reason, because as you can probably imagine, the more filters and shielding you add, the heavier something becomes. That's always not always as realistic as well. How do you recover from this? Well, this is what I said. At some point you need to make this, you need to do this balancing exercise. Do I protect against everything, spend a lot of money, but I don't, and then have to make it redundant and do the same thing there? Or is it cheaper for me to have just redundancy and very efficient ways of getting back online or getting back to do my primary process as a company? These are all decisions you have to make. So this is, I hope this is clear. This pretty much summarizes what this says here. It's very difficult, and it's often highly tailored to the environment you're in. It can even be wildly different for a company itself. For instance, I can guarantee you that there are very different needs and requirements for the, once again, for instance, the power companies, for what they do with their grid and what they do with their IT systems. They will have hugely different requirements. The power delivery, I'm pretty sure that they have very sure that continues on. If they have some kind of problem with their internal IT network because the routers keep crashing, it's fine as long as their power supply systems keep running. They'll have hugely different requirements for that. So you can probably see how complex this field is just by this. So what do you do to integrate these things? You have detection and prevention devices. Well, we've heard about that. You do things like firewalling and so on. It's generally more effective if you have a central control. And this is a trend you will see in many companies, that they, rather than having their security spread out over all these different branches and different uses, they will still have these people primarily concerned with a central division, but have them work together so they know what they're doing from each other, because at one point or other they are still exchanging some kind of information or interconnecting their systems. So it's very advantageous to have them together. So control in more means than one. For physical and security, you might have ID cards, central management, and so on. It's pretty strict. They are talking about single step card enrollment and termination. So it's, in other words, very simple to give someone a card and revoke it in certain ways. But this is specifically singled out. I added that. A single ID card does not mean you have one-step one-step authentication. Don't forget that. It doesn't mean you only have an ID card. It might still be that you also need to have a thumbprint, also an iris scan, also a password, maybe funny gestures if you're whatever the means of encryption is or authentication. So the problem is there are lots of different and competing standards for this. We're seeing generically available tools that are coming now for this. Does anyone here have a YubiKey, for instance? And Google has also published an open system where they offer you a Google key, which is like a normal two-step authentication thing. Anyone? Nobody worked with it yet? Okay, yeah? Yeah.
It's a Gmail for a company. We use a two-step verification.
Yeah. Do you have YubiKeys or the new Google things?
I use the authenticator app.
Oh, the authenticator app. Okay, so that's basically an app on your phone. Yeah, it's also a two-step. But for what you will mostly see in companies is things like RSA tokens, for instance. That's very popular, but that's all closed again, and there's been a lot of discussion on whether or not RSA has their affairs in order, and there have been things going wrong with those. Yes?
Google also has Google Device Policy if you use a corporate email on your Android phone, which it locks and encrypts your phone.
Mm-hmm.
And in the case of losing your phone, the company that owns the corporate email can delete or reset the device from distance without opening the email.
Okay, that's not really about authentication. It's important what you're now saying is important, but it's much more about detection and mitigation of security incidents. That's not really about authenticating people in this case. But we'll get to that later on. So I'm skipping this. There are a lot of sheets like this, and you can probably see why I'm going to skip this. It's almost unreadable, particularly if you're in the back of the office. There are some description standards. I just showed you the FIPS. This is the federal standard from the US for it. There are also similar standards or frameworks for describing the security and control you have for these accesses. Uncontrolled, hooray, everyone can walk onto the terrain or into the building. Controlled, well, nothing too special. So, for instance, let's say in the case of the HVA, what would be a controlled area?
The lab.
No, you're too detailed right now.
Locale.
Yeah, just a locale. That's a generic access for everyone with a normal employee card. What would be limited access? Not a classroom, but a
teacher room.
Yeah, an office, one of the lecturer's office. Any idea what would be an exclusion area? Yes. And the point is, I have these levels of access on my card, even though they're different levels. So you also don't necessarily, this doesn't necessarily mean that you have different devices for all these things. So try to see, keep the disconnect between an implementation of someone and the description. How you implement these kinds of things is something else. Different way of looking at it. See? You're actually room housing trade secrets. Ooh, well, that could be a server room. Why not? Lab space and other sensitive areas. As I said before, office wasn't even that bad as a suggestion. Controlled area, classrooms, and so on. You've all seen the S&E lab on the fourth floor, I'm guessing. It's pretty close to what's being described here already. Okay, so in summary, we've only done something about physical security today and about the overall parts of a network. This was mostly just the physical layer. So rather than repeat everything that we've just covered, I want to once again implore you that security, I'm sure there are many people who do this, I'm certainly not one of them, who are capable of doing this, but it's very difficult to know everything about security, about every aspect, on every layer. It's been my experience, but yours might differ. I don't know if yours differs, for instance, but most security experts are specialists in a certain field, in my experience. One or more fields, still possible. But it's hard to be a security expert who knows everything and who can think about everything. And it's the same thing for those of you who are minor students with forensics. It's hard to be an expert in malware and reverse engineering and an expert in big data and an expert in this. You might be an expert at one point in one or two fields. So what I would encourage you to do is, for instance, if you're still looking for a project and if you don't or you have a product, is try to find out where your interest is. You obviously have an interest because you're here. You signed up for the theme semester. But if you have a specific focus, something that you really like, try to specialize in that. It's incredibly difficult to do everything and know everything in this field. There's never impossible, but it's difficult. Okay, so I'll leave it at that for now. I want to know if there are any questions about today. You seem to be all silent. Have I just all talked you into a depression about with the complexity of security, or?
Well, actually, what I find interesting, most of these solutions actually also create new opportunities to
explore. Yeah. That's a very good observation. At the front row, someone just mentioned that a lot of the solutions you have to these security incidents can create their own possible attack vectors, is the term you would use for that. And they're coming to get me again. Yeah, that is a problem. And like I said, boils down, once again, security is as strong as the weakest link. So I gave the example of someone leaving the door open. You have the best lock on the door, but someone leaves the door open. This happens a lot. You have the best password policy in the in the world, but someone leaves post-it notes with their passwords on them. And that is often a very realistic scenario. Don't forget that. Because if you have very strict and very good password policies, people at one point will start to get annoyed with having to change their passwords constantly. So they will either use easy-to-guess passwords, they will start numbering, or other ways of doing that, and it will become predictable or easy to guess. So that's a good point. Many mitigation or many prevention, detection, or mitigation measures you do as a security expert can cause new problems, or new potential possible problems. One after the other. Okay, so any other questions? Okay. Are there any other questions about the theme semester or the minor right now? I would also like to know that because I don't see you. Oh, excuse me. I don't see you as often as it used to be with the minor. So if there are any questions, I would like to know. If not, or if it's something private, please just email us at the addresses. Okay, then that's it. Thank you all for coming. And I will see you next week.